feet, I lay my life. From the ends of the earth to the heights of heaven, your glory, Lord, is far and wide. Through history you reign on high. From the depths of the sea to the mountain summit, your power, Lord, it knows no bounds. A higher love cannot be found. So let the universe proclaim your great power and your great name. The whole earth is filled with your glory, Lord. Mountains bow and oceans roar. Creation longs for what's in store. May you be honored and glorified, exalted and lifted high. Here at your feet I lay my life. The whole earth is filled with your glory, Lord. Angels and earth adore. Creation longs for what's in store. May you be honored and glorified, exalted and lifted high. Here at your feet I lay my life.
Was my guitar not coming through? Is that better? I had the wrong button pushed. It's all good. Welcome to church, everyone. It's really great to see you this morning, and it's awesome to be in God's house together and be able to praise Him. And so today is Palm Sunday. Can you believe it? Everything came really fast, and we're going to sing the song Hosanna. Praise is rising, and we were asking the team this morning, so does anyone here, pop quiz, know what the Hebrew word Hosanna means? Yes, it's all like really, really close and in the same vein. It's God save us or save us now, and it comes from Psalm 118. I don't know who said that, but they win.
Eleanor.
Eleanor. Eleanor cheated a little bit. She was at Moberly this week. We were talking about it.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Cause when we see you, we find strength. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Sound of heart dreams
tears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all. The day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Let everything praise the Lord. Let everything, Let everything praise the Lord. Let everything praise the Lord.
Joy still comes in the morning.
Hope still walks with the
early. You're still alive and breathing.
Praise the Lord.
Don't stop dancing and dreaming.
Still good news will
remain. Lift your head and
still walks with the hurting.
You're still alive and breathing.
Praise the Lord.
Don't stop dancing and dreaming.
Still good news worth repeating.
So lift your head and keep singing.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. You may be seated. At this time, it's the time of the service where we take up our tithe and our offering. So as the guys come forward, let's all bow in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, our mighty God, we come before your heavenly throne of grace this morning, Lord, and we come here to praise you and to think about you and to learn about you, and I just pray, Lord, that we all come here, that you would help us by your Spirit to be changed by you. Help us, God, all of us, in Jesus' name, that we would not be stiff-necked or proud before you. That you would help us to be on our knees, on our face before you, the King of Kings. In this Palm Sunday, God, we remember that amazing day, that day in history where you, God, in the person of Jesus, rode into Jerusalem on that little donkey. I pray, Lord, we sung Hosanna today. We pray that, God, save us. We praise you, God, because you save us now. You save us from our sin. You save us from death and hell. I pray, Lord, that you would wash away all the familiarity of things that seems to make those things just seem like another Sunday, and help us to see everything anew. And as we take up these tithes and the offerings, Lord, we give them as praise and worship to you. And we ask, God, that you would put your hand of blessing upon them, that you would glorify yourself in our hearts, in our whole life, not just our Sundays. Lord, that you would bring glory to yourself through us all through the week, so that Revelstoke might see that you are God and you are good. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
He knows the name of my sorrows, and he knows the name of my . Why should I let them bother me? For I know he is near. Oh, to be loved by Jesus.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing alleluia, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing alleluia, Christ is risen.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the church this morning. If you're visiting or a first timer, and we're glad to have you. And this is our time for our pastoral prayer on Sunday morning. And we pray for one of the other churches in town. Today we want to remember and include our fellow believers at the Seventh-day Adventist Church and to pray for them as they gather, even though they don't gather on Sunday, but we pray for them all the same. And our missionaries are Diego and Claudia Cardona. We're just praying for the church in Caldas and for the El Rodel churches. We want to remember Diego and Claudia and their and the other believers that are in Colombia. And before we go to prayer, I was reading this morning in Proverbs chapter 14. I just want to always include a few verses here. This is verse 24, 25. Wealth is a crown for the wise, and the effort of fools yields only foolishness. A truthful witness saves lives, but a false witness is a traitor. Those who fear the Lord are secure, and he will be a refuge for their children. For fear of the Lord is a life-giving fountain, and it offers escape from the snares of death. So let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we come this morning with thankful hearts for you, our God, and you have extended mercy and grace to us, your children, your people, your creation. You have brought peace to us through the Lord Jesus Christ, your Son. And in that, we just give thanks wholeheartedly. We want to lift your name high and to praise you for what you've done. And Lord, just those words in Proverbs 14 about a truthful witness, we ask that as believers that you would encourage us by your Spirit in our day-to-day walk to bear witness for you, for what you've done in our lives, and that in doing so, you might be able to bring others to yourself. And today we just remember the church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Revelstoke, and we think of them and how they serve the community, and they work hard, and so we pray for them. Please encourage them through your word, and each week as they read your word and proclaim it, we ask that you would provide for their needs, and that together, Lord, in our community, we might minister the gospel, and that it might be used mightily by you to draw people to yourself and into your kingdom. We ask also that you would, we just want to pray for Diego and Claudia Cardona, and we think also specifically of the believers in Caldas, and we think of the Columbia team that went last fall or last year, and we learned about them and how hard they work, and we pray for them. We ask, Lord, for your care in the lives of our fellow Colombian believers in and around the area with the El Rodel churches, and we just pray, Lord, for Diego and Claudia. Please encourage them in their own faith, in their marriage, and as they support other believers in their work around the area. And we pray for the church in Caldas, Lord, please encourage them and please provide for their needs. And we thank you, Lord, that we can partner with them and that you've continued this relationship with them between us and them. It's a wonderful thing and we've been encouraged by it. We also just want to pray for our service today. We pray for Pastor Jordan. I thank you for all the songs, Lord, that we can sing. And Lord, we sing them from our heart as a praise to you, as our worship. We ask, Lord, that you would be with us in spirit as we hear your word read and as we study together. Lord, may we, in turn, as we learn from your word, turn around and give thanks and to say thank you to you and to give you praise and to give you worship. You deserve it. And so we thank you also for the worship team. And Lord, we just pray for those who are traveling today, those who might be sick and shut away at home, or that might be also listening online. And we ask, Lord, that you would bless them, that may they be encouraged today in your word. And we just pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Thanks so much, Shane. There's a few announcements before we get started here. I'm not sure. If there's anybody here who is getting baptized next week, so we have five getting baptized, or if anyone else would like to be baptized, I'm going to be. If you can all meet me up here right after the service, right concluding the service, and we're going to go over a few things, and that would be great. Also, this week is a big reminder about Maundy Thursday. So we're having our Maundy Thursday potluck. So please bring a main dish and a salad or a dessert. And that's this Thursday. That'll be here at the church at 6 p.m. And so we're all going to eat together. And then we're going to go over, we're going to have a short service, which goes from the Last Supper right to the crucifixion, and to be able to actually have communion together as well, as we remember all of the events leading up in this Passion Week to the crucifixion of our Jesus. And so that's something that it's a little bit more of a somber night, but something that I really look forward to every year. It's very precious. So this Thursday at 6. We are also looking for food safe volunteers. I think we had one or two come forward who are willing to, but if you could talk to myself or Jen or Nicole, that would be great. And that's it. That's good for announcements for now, I think. All right, if you have a Bible, because we got to really get out, or this is a full-on sermon today. There's a lot to get through. If you have a Bible, please turn to Matthew, the Gospel according to Matthew. Oh yes, Summit kids, you're dismissed downstairs, as well as I believe the With Korean and Jesus will be downstairs right now as well. So you can turn to Matthew 21. We're going to be reading starting in verse 1 and going to verse 11. Is it 11 or 12? 11. And so today, like we just said earlier, today is Palm Sunday. And whenever you hear about Palm Sunday, you also hear that it's also called the triumphal or the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And so it's this day where Jesus, he enters into Jerusalem, he's heralded by all the people, they're waving the palm branches and shouting, as we saw this morning, Hosanna, save us now, and quoting from Psalm 118. And he's coming into Jerusalem as Messiah, and as we were talking about this morning, also as king, heralded as king. But as we also know now, as we look back, we know this is the beginning of Jesus' last week on this earth. And this is what we call Passion Week. It's his final week on earth. It's the culmination of Jesus' life, and it's the culmination of all human history. All four Gospels contain an account of Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem, but today we're going to be reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. If you don't mind, I know we just prayed. I want to pray one more time. There's a lot in this sermon. Dear Heavenly Father, I just ask, Lord, in your mercy, in Jesus' name, that you would help this message, your words, to be clear. Please help me not to bring any confusion or anything like that. I pray for clarity, and in the end, we might worship you through all of that we look at this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Matthew 21, verses 1 to 12. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, he says, hey, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her.
untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken of the prophet, saying, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the ground. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred, saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. So I'd like to do something a little bit different this morning. We've just read through Matthew's account, but instead of going through this passage verse by verse, is what I normally do, I just wanted to read this as a reminder of the whole scene of Palm Sunday. But what we're going to do is we're going to rewind back to the very beginning of all things. And we're going to make our way right to the book of Revelation, if you can believe it or not. And I want to do this so that we can maybe begin to see and scratch the surface of some of the amazing themes and hints in the Old Testament that point and lead towards the culmination of God's plan on this day, on Palm Sunday, and the week that follows. One of the amazing themes in the Bible that I've talked about over these last couple years is this, that God has chosen that his primary way of working in this world is to be through apparent weakness and apparent foolishness, and through what seems to be impossible. 1 Corinthians 1:27 says, God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. And God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. This past week, as I have been reading and thinking about Palm Sunday, I was struck very deeply in my heart with the imagery around the day. Most notably, the imagery of Jesus riding on a donkey. And I want everybody in here to just pause for a second and try and think about this. Try to imagine this. Because I know that many of us have all heard the story of Palm Sunday a million times. Many of us colored Sunday school things of Jesus on the donkey when we were little kids, but it's very familiar. But what I would ask you to do and pray in your hearts is try and push aside all the familiarity that you feel of this passage and picture it again for the first time. Jesus, the Son of God. Jesus, the Son, the member of the Trinity. Jesus, as it says in that hymn in Colossians 1, the Creator. Your Creator, the King of Kings, the Eternal Holy One of God. Right now, Palm Sunday, it's His moment, it's His time, it's like called the fullness of time, where Jesus is now going to save the world. And in a choice that was made from before even the creation of the world, Jesus chooses on the day that's going to be His triumphant entry into Jerusalem as Messiah and as King, He chooses to come in riding on a donkey. Just think about that. Not a war horse. Not like some beautiful white steed. Not a chariot. Not even just a donkey, actually. It says a donkey's kid, a donkey's child, a donkey's colt. And this really got to me this week. I already know it, but it just hit me fresh. Picturing Jesus going up that hill and then entering Jerusalem on a little half-grown donkey, like a puppy donkey, with floppy ears and awkward limbs, probably making awkward sounds, like hee-haw. And Jesus with his feet probably scraping on the ground. Think about that. Think about how different Jesus is than you or I or anyone else in this world. We don't like to appear weak or frumpy or awkward. And we all do this. We've all in our lives, we spent hours in front of the mirror trying to ensure that we don't come across weird to the world or weak. If we have a job interview, we certainly don't want to appear weak. When we meet new people or we go to a church for the first time or even for the millionth time, we spend time ensuring that we're putting our best foot forward so that we appear like healthy, confident people and competent, like we were talking last week. And think about this. Think about every king or queen who's ever lived. Whenever they've had a parade or a triumphant entry into some city, think of the hours and the astronomical dollars that are spent on that day with stylists and tailors and blacksmiths creating special parade golden suits of armor. And then the servants scurrying around the whole country, sorting through, trying to find the choicest of breed and breeding of horses for him to ride. Even think about the popes. You remember seeing some of the popes who would ride on that, people would carry on this huge ornate chair. It looked like a throne. So think about how strange this story is, how bizarre it is. The creator of the universe, right? Remember Jesus, even the wind, the disciples say, even the wind and the waves obey him. Like the reality is that every flower that you grow in your garden this summer is designed personally by him. Jesus, the only one who is worthy to actually have people bow to him. And he chooses to ride into Jerusalem on a little colt donkey. Why did he do that? What's with the donkey? So this morning, I'm gonna tell you, and then I'm going to show you. And in the end, I think there's still going to be some mystery, which is always with the Bible. And there might be a lot of rabbit trails that you might want to go in your Bible reading and investigate down. As I said earlier, God's primary way of working in this world is through weakness. We see it over and over and over again in the Bible. But here we see it in grand fashion. On one side, we have what I'm going to use as a metaphor, and I'm going to describe today as I'm calling it the dark, formidable tower of evil. The dark tower of evil. So let's just imagine this huge tower, kind of like something that you would see out of Lord of the Rings. A huge black tower that looks terrifying and formidable. It's fortified with weapons, and all the forces of darkness are inside, and its gates are called the gates of hell. And then imagine this tower, and a ways in front of this tower, imagine a tiny figure. A man. A man with regular, unflashy, day-to-day, common Jewish robes on. A blue-collar working man. And he's sitting on a young donkey. And slowly, ever so slowly, he's moving towards this dark tower. This is my picture for you on Palm Sunday. But to help you think about this and understand this picture better, we're going to go back into the Old Testament. So first, we're going to look at the dark tower of evil. So in the beginning of Genesis, There's Adam and Eve, man and woman, created in the image of God. And they lived in this garden paradise. There was no sin, there was no disease, no cancer, no violence, no selfishness and pride, no shame, no loneliness. But in Genesis 3, remember this, the serpent, Satan, the deceiver, he enters the scene and he tempts Eve. And he tempts her with this idea of becoming like God. He's like, don't you want to be like God? Where you know the difference between good and evil? You know, like you, that don't you want to be like you no longer need to trust and rely on God? Instead, you can become like him. And we all know what happens. And in this moment, pride and rebellion are born, conceived into the human race. Eve and Adam, in direct disobedience of God's one request, they eat the one fruit that God forbid, the one thing he said not to do. And in that moment, the dark tower of evil had its foundation poured. Romans 5:12 says, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. Right? Evil and death exist because Adam and Eve, and then every single person since, sinned. It's like we all saw God here. And in our hearts, we've all done it. We all said, no, I want to go that way. I want to go this way, away from him. I want to go my own way. And so after this original sin happens, in the first prophecy about Jesus in the Bible, God says to Satan, Genesis 3:15, he's prophesying, God's telling what's going to happen about Jesus. He says to Satan, he will crush your head, Satan, but you will bruise his heel. This is our first indication of God has a plan to deal with evil. Yet, at the time, through these actions of Adam and Eve, God in his plan and his ways allows mankind to have free will, to have the choice to sin. And so sin flourishes. And death and evil rooted itself into this planet. And deception and pride begin to feed on itself. And like sheep who've gone astray, Isaiah 53, 5 and 6, like sheep who've gone astray away from the shepherd's pen, each new day in the world brought humanity the kind of the tingle and the thrill of moving farther away from God into those dark forest paths. Each step taken in the opposite direction of God was met with encouragements from the devil, where he would whisper, every step take further from God, say, see, nothing's happening to you. Nothing's happening. You're fine. Keep going. All the while, each individual man and woman, unaware of the wolves in the darkness, not perceiving that the bricks of the dark tower were being forged at a furious pace. By Genesis 6, sin had spread so rapidly that it was said in Genesis 6, 5, that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. You know the story. It was so bad that God brought a flood of judgment on the earth, saving only Noah and his family and two of each kind of animal and bird according to their kinds. The flood ended. The wrath of God receded with the flood. But man continued to sin. And as humanity multiplied, so did the construction of the dark tower of evil. Brick by brick. Violence by violence. Perversion by perversion. Rebellion. Narcissism, hate, and pride. By Genesis 11, we see the pride of man and its desire to be independent from God at a fever pitch. Man decides together. Let's actually build a real tower. Remember this? Let's build a real tower to heaven by ourselves. We don't want God. We want to get in there and war against God. This is the heart. The Tower of Babel. And so they build this actual physical tower. And I like to think it's a physical representation of the spiritual dark tower behind everything. The spiritual dark tower of evil, that invisible tower that towers over humanity. Its gates threatening to swallow every individual born into this world. But again, in God's mercy and God's patience and his patience for his plan, God doesn't destroy man again. He instead, the Tower of Babel, you know it, he confuses the languages of everyone. He separates everyone's language into different languages so they can't understand each other, and he spreads them across the earth. Yet this unseen dark tower, it still exists. The shadow of death falls across all humanity. Right? Cancer exists. Injustice exists. Tragedy exists. Evildoers exist. People who abuse other people. Rage, hate, violence, hopelessness, fear and pain. All kinds of evil and all the results of evil, all these bricks in the tower. And we watch the news, and we even, sometimes you don't have to watch the news, you just look at the news of your own life, right? And you see the tower appears formidable. It appears impossible to break, to penetrate. Yet the reality is most don't actually see it for what it actually is. They don't see because what evil does is it enshrouds itself in all things that are pleasant and attractive to the eye. Just like Satan made evil attractive to the eyes of Eve and Adam. Sin looks good. Sin always looks like the right way. And there's appearance of strength to paths of sin and an appearance of happiness. Where when you consider Jesus to the world, he seems like folly. To many, he just seems plain and unattractive and boring. Look at him. I mean, he's just sitting there on a little donkey. Feet scraping the ground. Like, what can he do? So we've looked at this dark tower of evil. Now let's go back in time again and be really specific. And what I want to do is a little bit strange, but I want to look at the donkey in the Bible. I want to be very clear, the donkey doesn't save. It's not the answer. But why on earth did Jesus choose to ride a donkey? This question, and this interest in donkey in the Bible sent me scurrying through the Old Testament, and I felt like I was an ant trying to eat an apple because there's so much to sift through. And I began to notice that there are many stories and many passages that have donkeys in them. Much more than I can look at this morning. It's like the donkey's not the main character, but he's mentioned. It's almost like if we had Polaroid pictures of Old Testament stories. If we had Polaroid pictures, there would be the main story in the foreground. But if you look a little closer, you see, oh, there's a donkey in there too. And you say, how interesting is that? In Genesis 22, there's the story of Abraham and Isaac. One of the most significant foreshadowing stories of Easter week in the Old Testament. So God asks Abraham to take his son. It says the literal words, his son, his one and only son, Isaac, and sacrifice him to God on Mount Moriah. So if you don't know, it's strongly believed by scholars and by the Jews that Mount Moriah is either the modern-day Temple Mount or it is just outside of Jerusalem where Jesus was crucified, the hill. And so this story, when you think about what happened back then and what happened with the crucifixion, it's full of imagery which foreshadows the one true sacrifice for all people. So Abraham and Isaac, they go up the hill. But remember that right before Abraham sacrifices Isaac, God says, stop. And he provides a ram as a sacrifice. And Abraham names the place, the Lord will provide. Jehovah Jireh. And ultimately we see this as a foreshadowing. Because in this exact spot, God ultimately provides in a once-for-all sacrifice for sins. In God's loving kindness, God provides His Son, His one and only Son, Jesus, for us on the cross. But there's something, as we look at this story, that's interesting. I'm not going to say it's the most significant thing in the world, but it's there. In the background of the Polaroid of this story, there's a donkey. Abraham saddles up a donkey to go up the hill. Most scholars think that it was for Isaac so that he could carry Isaac up the same hill that Jesus would one day go up on a donkey and enter Jerusalem. Genesis 49, 10 to 11. Jacob, he's nearing the final moments of his life. And he blesses his boys, his 12 boys who would become the 12 tribes of Israel. And Jacob, it's like he prophesies about their future days. And when he gets to Judah, remember Judah? Revelation 5:5, Jesus is the lion from the tribe of Judah. When Jacob gets to Judah, he says, the scepter, right? The king's scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he to whom it belongs shall come. And the obedience of the nations will be his. It's this prophecy of Jesus. And we're going to see more of this in passages as we go. The obedience of the nations. Now listen to this. Verse 11. He will tether his donkey to a vine, his colt to the choicest branch. He will wash his garments in wine and his robes in the blood of grapes. Many scholars I read, they think of this, that it is ultimately looking towards Palm Sunday and the whole hope of Easter. First of all, I just want to pause and say here for a moment that donkeys are looked upon by the Jews as a symbol of peace. Because when you're at peace, you use your donkey. You don't use war horses and chariots and things like that. When you're at peace, you're busy farming and doing, you know, whatever kind of work around the property that a donkey needs. So a donkey symbolized peace. And scholars believe that this idea of peace and hope and plenty, future peace, hope, and plenty, is insinuated by Jacob. Because you think about how it says here, he will tether his donkey to a vine, to the choicest vine. No one would tether their donkey to the choicest vine. Because donkeys are kind of like goats. They just eat all the grapes off of it. But if you're at peace and you have so much you don't worry about running out, then sure, tether your great donkey up to the vine. It was like a Jewish expression. And so there's this foreshadowing of peace through the Lion of Judah. But even deeper than this, we think about this. Jesus rode the donkey up into Jerusalem, and he is the true vine. And he was flogged and beaten, and his robes were stained by his own blood. And our sins washed by his blood, which we remember on communion when we drink juice from the vine. Or wine. I know I'm bringing up all kinds of thoughts here and I just leave them hanging. You go investigate on your own. Another obvious Polaroid snapshot of a donkey in the Old Testament is Numbers 22. maybe the most obvious, Balaam and his donkey who can actually talk, at least for a moment. And I don't have time to get into these stories fully because there's so much more meaning to them. I encourage you to go home and investigate them, but it's really fascinating because Balaam, he's not Jew, he's a Gentile called a seer or a diviner. And that was what he was known for, that he could see the future or he could see things. Yet in the story, it's the simple donkey who can actually see, not Balaam. Remember, there's this angel that stands in the way with sword drawn to block the way. And Balaam, he doesn't see him at all. But the donkey does. And at one point, the donkey actually talks. And by his words and through his actions, he ends up saving Balaam. 1 Corinthians 27, God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. And God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. A donkey is not considered to be wise. Yet he is the one who's actually wise, shaming the one who's supposed to be wise. In 1 Kings 1, Warren brought this up this morning. 1 Kings 1, and we don't have time to get into the fullness of this story either, but there's really interesting similarities which foreshadow Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And so this is where one of David's sons, Adonijah, he's plotting to make himself king. And so David, he's really old and he's frail and he's laying in bed, but Solomon, remember Solomon, David and Bathsheba's son, he's the one promised to carry the line of David, which is ultimately going to be the promised line that Jesus would come from. And so through a bunch of circumstances, David finds this out, that his son is planning to like abdicate and take the throne. And he gets his men to go and get Solomon, put him on his own donkey, and ride into Jerusalem to become king. And King Solomon goes, and it says among the people there was all this fanfare and happiness as he ride King David's donkey, the same route that Jesus would ride 1,000 years later. This all was happening as Adonijah, in another part, he's plotting away destruction and trying to take the throne. And there's this similarity of the feel of the situation. Whereas Jesus rides into Jerusalem, if you read further and everything, you see the Pharisees and the leaders and the teachers of the law, they're plotting to kill Jesus. Now we know Solomon was not like Jesus, but we can see how this triumphant entry into Jerusalem points forward to another further king, King Jesus, the good and true King of Kings. How he would enter that same city. Now this brings us to my final donkey-related passage for today, Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 and 10. This is a prophecy of Jesus the Messiah written 550 years before Jesus entered Jerusalem. And this passage is directly quoted, if you remember back to what we read this morning, Matthew 21. It's directly quoted Matthew 21:5, and it's also quoted in John's account of the same story in John 12:15. And so I'm going to read it right now. Zechariah 9, 9 and 10. And there's so much if you have more time to read around these verses as well to the context. But Zechariah 9, 9 and 10 says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Language scholars say that the Hebrew word for coming to you can also mean coming for your benefit. So let's just pause there before we read on. Just think about this for a second. Imagine the picture of everything that we've been talking about so far. Here's Jesus, all humble and lowly, not concerned a bit with how he looks to the world. not concerned with being on a golden chariot or a war horse. Jesus, the King of Kings, probably has dusty robes, sitting on a colt of a donkey, feet scraping the ground, riding into the Jerusalem, knowing full well that the same people who are waving the branches and shouting Hosanna are going to turn on him 5 days later. Picture him, this figure on a donkey climbing the hill to face the massive dark tower of evil. This present darkness, bristling with violence and buzzing with demons. A tower built brick by brick with sin and deception. This dark tower which holds all humanity in chains, seeking to devour mankind into eternal darkness. And Zechariah 9:9 says, "Behold, entire world, your king is coming to you. He's coming for your benefit. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Then God says, verse 10, "I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off." Right? Jesus is not coming as a political, military conqueror, as everyone expected. Instead, verse 10, "He shall come, he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth." Palm Sunday, to me, is a picture of how God has decided to do things. His primary way of working is through the perceived weakness, through what seems foolish and impossible to the world. The small figure on the colt of a donkey before the dark tower of evil. Imagine, from the ramparts of the tower, we hear laughter, wicked laughter. The darkness has been plotting. It has been planning this week for Jesus. And evil gnashes its teeth. It's like it can't wait. But we see Jesus, his eyes are set. His eyes are firm. His time is now. Psalm 37, 12 and 13 says, "The wicked plot against the righteous and gnash their teeth at him. But the Lord laughs at the wicked, for he knows their time has come." In 5 days, the perceived weakness of the man who chose from before the creation of the world to include the lowliest of all animals, the sweet donkey. In 5 days, the perceived weakness and folly of God would calmly remove the key foundation piece of the dark tower of evil. I was imagining just like Jenga, taking the one last piece out. The foundation of sin would be removed, and the dark tower, with all its perceived power, begins to crash with a roar. I think we live in the middle of that crash. Right? The dust hasn't settled. We still hear the roar as it comes down of evil, of those last few seconds of evil. But there's a day coming that's much sooner than any of us expect when we will see that same humble and lowly Jesus who rode on a donkey, where we will see him face to face. And the tower of evil and the shadow it casts, right? Psalm 23, the valley of the shadow of death will be no more. And Zechariah 9:10 alludes even to interestingly enough, to the effects of the physical Tower of Babel. Even the effects of the physical Tower of Babel will be reversed. Jesus will rule all nations from sea to sea. So no longer in the end will we be scattered. No longer will we be lost and separated. No longer will racism exist between peoples on the earth, for we will all see him. And so I'm going to close with one last passage here and just let it sit with you. Revelation 7, 9 to 12. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. He was clothed in white robes with palm branches in our hands. See that, guys? We're going to have Palm Sunday in heaven. With palm branches in their hands and crying out with a loud voice, all people sing, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne too, and the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord, at the end of that. I feel too small to speak those words. Lord, to think that this is true. This is true. That all peoples, all who turn their heart to you from every tribe and tongue and nation, we will all be shouting Hosanna with palm branches in our hands for eternity, God. And we come before you, and I guess, Lord, when we think of a message and the practical application, I think today is worship. May our hearts worship you, Lord, in spirit and truth because of what you've done. May our lives be actions of worship. May our lives look to others like that person is worshiping God with her life. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Worship team. I would stand if you're... It's an older song written with the same words from that passage in Revelation 7.
Salvation belongs to our God, who sits upon the throne. On to the Lamb, praise and glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and power and strength, be to our God forever and ever, be to our God. Shall be strong in fervor.
glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and power and strength. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Praise and glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and power and strength. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Amen.
Let's sing it all one more time.
Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, we're going to be singing a version of that. We know one day in heaven. Lord, help us, help everyone this day, people who got to travel, people who are staying. Lord, please lead us and guide us in your life. Help us to follow you, the man who rode in on a donkey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys. You're dismissed. And maybe if there's anyone, the people here who are going to be baptized, if you could come to the front.